Thank you, Madam Mayor. Question to the Leader of the Council. Can the Leader update us on his visit to New York?
Councillor Davies.
Yeah, I certainly can. The Bloomberg Foundation, headed by Mike Bloomberg, former Mayor of New York, and Harvard University have funded a programme called the City Leadership Initiative, which is aimed at improving the ability of leaders to address many of the issues that we're all trying to address, things like how do we achieve inclusive growth in our local economy, how do we make sure that local people can benefit from any investment and job creation, how do we deal with making sure that as many of our young people, children and young people as possible are school ready. All of these key issues are being addressed by many cities across the world. And the Bloomberg Foundation have, as part of the philanthropic work that Mike Bloomberg does, has funded a programme to enable mayors and leaders and senior officers from 10 cities, one of which is Liverpool City Region, another was Greater Manchester, there was a city in Canada and the rest of America cities, to address these issues and to gain the benefit of the incredible experience that the people from Harvard and Liverpool can bring to this agenda. Thing to just emphasise is that all funding for everything was provided by Bloomberg, so can reassure Councillor Blakely that this council did not have to foot a penny of the expense. It was all funded by the philanthropic monies that Mike Bloomberg makes available. The intention is to continue the dialogue, and there is an ongoing programme of sharing good practice between those 10 cities. And I felt it was very, very intensive, but it was a very useful 4 days of my time. And there were a number of colleagues from the rest of us. Essentially, that was the programme.
Thank you.
Thank you. Councillor Gilchrist, I'm going to take you next. I've seen you bobble up and down, then I'll ask everybody else to get your hand.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I've submitted a question to Councillor George Davies to give him some notice of the issue. The Cabinet Portfolio Report refers to the very welcome addition of 181 new affordable homes to Wirral's stock. The Wirral plan set out the hope and expectation that 3,500 new homes would be built by 2020. Does the creation of the Ministry of Housing, Communities and Local Government provide Wirral with further opportunities to increase the number of affordable homes in Wirral? What work is being undertaken with housing associations to meet local needs?
Thank you, Councillor Davies.
Yeah, thank you. They're already being allocated, but still, never mind. Thank you for the question, Phil. Let me just get my answer. Okay. The Ministry of Housing, Communities and Local Governments, formerly the Department of Communities and Local Government, has in place a single plan which sets out their objectives and how they will achieve. I'll give you a copy of this after Phil, but it gives you the link to there to get the information we're talking about. The plan sets out a range of measures which continue to provide opportunities for Wirral to build on its successful track record of delivering new affordable homes in the borough. In particular, through the existing shared ownership and affordable homes programme, which provides funding to support an increase in the supply of shared ownership and affordable housing in England by 2021. Registered providers initially successful accessed funding through this route to deliver affordable homes in the borough, with those early funding allocations awarded to registered providers housing associations, totaling over 8.4 million to deliver 283 units of affordable housing in Wirral by 2021. What work have we undertaken with housing associations to meet this need? Wirral Council is continuing to work with registered providers to identify new development sites and opportunities to provide more affordable homes in the borough. Registered providers are now progressing with bids for funding through Homes England's shared ownership and affordable homes programme. So as any new developments successfully funded through this route will be additional to the original 283 units secured initially. In addition, Wirral Council is continuing to review and identify potential council sites which could be recommended for sale to registered providers, specifically for the development of new affordable homes, and also has in place capital programmes to provide funding for the development of new affordable housing, including the provision of extra care housing to meet local needs. Thank you, Phil.
Thank you.
And there, I'm not sure that the protocol of getting the declaration of interest, because you don't know what questions are going to come up, but there was a linkage there between local housing associations, so for safety reasons, any questions remotely engaged with the work of the agenda, I will declare an interest. Is that okay with you, for the solicitor?
Thank you.
Okay.
I'd like to declare an interest as well, to the extent that you have some interest,
okay, can we take that as a block? Yes, Mayor, although from what was said, I'm not entirely convinced that they actually were interested.
I'm going to declare them anyway. So, right, I'm going to take in a second Councillor Paul Stuart. Then I'm going to take Councillor Leslie Rennie and then Councillor Dave Mitchell. Okay? And I'll ask everybody else to come up again. Councillor Stewart.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Can I ask the Cabinet Member for local listening and engage with Councillor Patrick to give the Council an update on the report back to constituents and committees on the open work?
Thank you. Councillor Patrick.
Thank you, Councillor Stewart. Yes, we attended between myself and Rachel Musgrave each of the four constituency committees to discuss the whatever model comes out of the review we're currently conducting into how the council operates in its neighbourhoods. I managed to do Birkenhead and Wirral West. I understand I've had some report back from Wallasey and from Wirral South. Informal reports I've had back from other councillors, members of the public and officers is that was generally well received. I think there were some good points that came back as a result of that. I would hope that all councillors of Phill have had an opportunity to engage in the process, and furthermore we're going to be sending out an additional final email just to all of the community groups to finish that up. Thanks for your question.
Thanks, Councillor Patrick. Yeah, Councillor
Rennie.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. My question also is to Councillor Matthew Patrick. Can I ask you, Matthew, what's been spending already in the approximation of £250,000 of public money on the Wirral View newspaper since its inception, and a projected further £140,000 in the next financial year? Do you really and truly believe that that means that community engagement is actually delivering value for money?
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I thought questions had to relate to the report, but when is that stuff was the year before? It's related to the content of the report of the questions went to me, but I'm happy to answer that anyway. I believe that Rural View is a sensible spending of money, and we previously spent more money than we do now communicating with far fewer residents across the borough. I think any opportunity for us to communicate with all residents at a lower price is a sensible one that we must take. I've said before, I'm open about this, I know that there have been difficulties with in terms of distribution. All members, we've got a collective mind, we've got 66 people around the chamber usually. Anybody who has any good ideas about how we can increase those rates, I'd be welcome to hear from you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Councillor
Mitchell.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Two questions to Councillor Stuart Whittingham. The first one is in relation to the...
I'll just stop it there, because it's just one question for the moment. Just taking one question from each member. If time allows, we can go back round again, but just one, please.
Okay. Well, the first question is in relation to the number of complications of appeared during the installation of the new road bridge from Wallasey to Cllr. How long will it now take before it's finally in place, or will it get the same accolades as its predecessor, being one of the strongest men in the world for holding the bridge up for so long.
Thank you, Brother. That's the bridge finished. There's several factors that need to align, which are outside our control, for the bridge to be successfully installed. The first one being the tide and the weather. The tide being because it needs to get the correct pressure on the docking, the wall picks, across the river, so the tide's not at the correct level, then the filter maintaining the water under the dock system. So as soon as those two things come together, then the bridge will be in, the bridge is ready to go in. The time between now and when the bridge is floated in is being used by the contractor to continue with the highways works and the other supporting infrastructure. And I'm confident that once it's in place, the actual time between it being put in place and being active traffic will be introduced.
Thank you.
I'm sorry,
Madam
Mayor, can you hear my question?
Yeah,
the question was what were the complications?
You come round again, you'll get the opportunity. Councillor Whittingham has given you a response. He's given you a response. And I want you to move on. Right. Does anybody else want to ask questions of any? Okay. Councillor Tony Smith, Councillor Wendy Clements, and Councillor Chris Carubia in that order. Thank you. So Councillor Tony Smith.
Okay, thank you, Madam Mayor. It's a question for the Cabinet Member for Children and Families, page 40. It's on preschool meals at the University of Wallasey. After the spring budget, it must be confusing to be a child. Until you're age 8, you're worthy of a preschool lunch. Then suddenly, you no longer need a preschool meal. And these are going to be vigorously tested under the universal credit, so that we'll now have to be earning about $7,300 a year. So that's a really low figure. Meanwhile, in that same spring budget, sorry it's a long question, Manager, all children are told in that budget that there's going to be 50 million set aside to look at values that underpin our society, including fairness, tolerance and respect. Would the Cabinet Member for Children and Families agree with me that it would be cheaper to practice these values rather than preach them?
Thank you. Councillor
Mooney. Yes. University credits as they're changing now are so complicated, so difficult to understand. We don't know how it's going to roll out. We don't know whether there's going to be fewer or more children getting free meals until it's rolled out. And it's not just that, we don't know how it's going to affect the school formula and the pupil premium, because that doesn't seem to have been mentioned in any of the paperwork that we've seen so far. All I can tell you is that there's 8,500 children here on Wirral getting free school meals at this present moment in time, which is 19% of the children on Wirral. Now, we reckon that one in three children in the North West is living in poverty, so that means that our children out there who should be claiming school meals who aren't. So we need to address that as well. But the poorest children in our society need our help to be fed. They're fed well, they learn well, and it underpins everything that we do at school. So, just to put it into some sort of examples for you, the pupil premium here on the Wirral is 12, the school funding formula is £12 million directly related to children with free school dinners, and the pupil premium is £16 million. That's a lot of money that we don't know how it's going to be worked out under the new universal credits rules. All we can do at this present moment in time is keep a very, very, very close eye on how universal credits affect the free school dinners and how it affects the most vulnerable children in society. The one thing I know is that the Tories haven't done anything really, really good for the vulnerable children, with social care being put and all that sort of stuff. We will keep a very close eye on it. The schools have worked really hard to get as many children as they possibly can onto free school dinners in the short time that we have up until this rolls out on the 1st of April. In the last 2 weeks, we had 300 children, just shy, I think it's 293 or 295, children sign up for free school dinners. So if any of you have children in your wards that could get free school dinners, get them to sign up as soon as possible so that the formulas as they stand can be applied for. And then it will take time to find out how universal credits is going to roll out and how it's going to affect our children, our vulnerable children. I hope it's positive. But on the history we have with the Conservatives, and I apologise to the people across the way, but you haven't stood up and shouted about this to your government. The history shows us that they're not very good at looking after vulnerable children. But Lord Porter, who's one of your own, will stand here and he'll disagree with you very, very vividly when he's here. £2 million is needed for us, but it's needed for the vulnerable children and for as we go forward for social children. We'll keep a close eye on it and we'll report back. But thank you very much for the question, Tony. I hope that covers all the aspects.
Thank you, Councillor Mooney. Councillor Andy Cummings.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Madam Mayor, I have a question to put on record for Councillor Angela Davies, just to ask her to tell us when the details of the review into libraries, leisure and culture will be shared with the staff, the friends, the groups and the public. But Councillor Bernie Mooney, could you please tell us whether you've met with those who are opposed to the pop-up birthing centre to allay their concerns?
I'm going to take your first question, and if time allows, we'll come back to the second one. I'll take the first question, which obviously Councillor Angela Davies isn't here, and you'll get a written response to that. If time allows, I'll ask Councillor Bernie Mooney to respond to the other one. Now I've got Councillor Chris Columbia, please.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I have a question also for Angela Davies, and she's not here to ask. Okay, so I'll ask a question instead to Councillor Whittingham. Could I ask Cabinet Member if as members we'll still be confined to not adding roads on the list of roads to be repaired? That we've been previously mentioned in our request repair list. Now we've got a list that says put down the roads in your ward that you request to be repaired, and we're not allowed to put in ones we've previously mentioned. Because I think we're going to have a problem in my ward with lighting colleagues long service before they're going to be running out of roads to mention.
Councillor Whittingham, can you answer that? Is there enough clarity around the question? Can you just clarify a little bit?
Sure. We're asking to name roads that we want repairs done on, and in your reports, it states, I'm delighted that this year we'll be able to invest significantly in many areas to improve conditions of our roads. When we're asked to fill in our list of roads to put forward for repairs, there's a caveat on it that says, do not include roads you've asked to be repaired before. Because we're running out of roads. Because they never get repaired.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. If you look on the cabinet page next week, there's a list of roads they get invested in investments. The list, the request that's sent around by the highway staff is just one part of the part of the folder that goes into the folder of that list. Vast majority of that is based on condition service, because I think council would agree that the best use of council taxpayers' money is to repair those roads with the biggest defects.
Thank you. Okay, so anybody else want to ask any questions? So I'm going to take Councillor Bruce Berry next, then I'm going to take Councillor Stuart Kelly, and then I'm going to take Councillor Cllr. Okay?
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I have a question for Councillor George Davies. In the Cabinet Member's report, he said that the Seacombe Wirral Hub is now fully operational. Can the Cabinet Member assure members that if the nuisance of scrambler bikes were to return this year, would Wirral be better placed this year to deal with the problem than it was last year, when scrambler bikes terrorised residents on high streets and in our parkland areas?
Thank you, Councillor Davies.
The answer to yes, The answer is, this thing to be yes. The idea of the hub is to bring all parts together so that when we get a concern, like exactly like you just mentioned, and I would imagine that everyone in this council has had that same problem about scramble bikes and 4x4s, everything else that's going on. I don't know where they get the time to do it to buy these things. But yeah, the police are in the best position now to enact that and take out those vehicles and bail them. Yes, the answer is yes, Bruce.
Thank you, Councillor
Davies.
Councillor Kelly.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I wonder if I could ask Mary Mooney, as Cllr member for Cllr Education, and following on from the point that Councillor Smith made about the disgraceful decision of government to remove free school meals from recipients of universal credit. Can I ask her whether in the last couple of weeks before the 1st of April she will intensify efforts to get the message to parents who may be on universal credit to ensure that they claim it before the 1st of April? My understanding is if they claim it before the 1st of April, then they will remain entitled during that phase of their education, and as she knows, the schools will be entitled to the pupil premium in the first place. Can I put to her two suggestions? Firstly, she will be aware, I am aware that the council's tweeting and uses its own website to put the message out there. But you'll be aware that a lot of schools have their own websites, have their own Facebook presence, have their own Twitter accounts, which access probably more successfully the parents of those schools. So can I ask that her department make contact with those schools, because it is in their best interest. The second suggestion of a main cutter, very briefly, my cutter if they have a response, is that there is going to be a new cohort of primary children coming into the education sector. The offer day, however, is the 16th of April, so it won't be at the top of people's agenda. Nevertheless, the council will have in its database the names and addresses of all the parents that have applied for a primary, for the first time, for a primary place. I wonder whether we are able to use that database in this instance, even though parents may not be aware of which primary school they're about to be allocated. But they will be allocated on the 16th, but they need to be aware before the 1st of April that if they're in receipt of universal credit, then they will be able to be entitled to free school meals, and then whichever school they are allocated will be entitled to premium.
We have a response to those suggestions. Thank you, Councillor Stuart, maybe for the first time also, but I totally agree with you, and Paul's here, so I'll make sure that Paul passes that on and relays it back to every school that we have, because I think you are right. The more people who sign up for the free school meals who are eligible for it now, including the new children who are coming in. That's why I said, you know, our members have got to do, the schools have got to do, we've got to do everything that's in our power to make sure that children who are entitled to preschool meals sign up for it and sign up for it as soon as possible. Okay, thanks, Stuart.
Councillor
McKeown.
Thank you, Madam
Mayor. I have a question for Councillor Philip Brightmore on page 33 of the report and the commitment to remove single-use plastic. Can you please advise when we can expect single-use plastic drink containers, like Eddie has conveniently provided here, when can we expect those to be removed from council buildings, please?
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Thank you for your question, Councillor Cllr. As you know, we're doing quite a lot of things around single-use plastics, but I'm proud to say we're the best in the city region with regards to this. We've already removed small plastic cups from water. Kind of suppliers, as you may find, we've got these small cardboard cups, aren't very good, but we'll get there in the end. The cups that we use when it comes to coffee, they are recyclable in certain ways. What I'm looking to do is not replace them in the short term, but make sure those which we use are recyclable. Thank you.
Okay,
I'm
going to start again. Anybody else want to ask any questions? Okay, Councillor Rowlands, and then Councillor Carubia again.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. This is a question to the Cabinet for Transport and Infrastructure. Councillor Stuart.
Can the Cabinet Member tell us what is being done to fill the 12 vacancies for school crossing patrols?
That was a question to Councillor Mooney.
No, that was
on there. Sorry. Sorry, Councillor Stuart Whittingham.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Again, it's not in my report. All questions must relate to whatever someone's report. However, I'm quite happy to answer. School crossing shows are traditionally very difficult to recruit to, particularly welfare reforms, because it's not financially attractive anymore. However, we are trying to recruit to those posts, and as people come to the service, they will be filled.
Thank you. Now, I'm going to take Councillor Carruthia, then Councillor Elderton, who was also standing, then Councillor Lewis, who was also standing. So, Councillor Carruthia.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I'll make this one an easier question. This one's for Councillor Christine Jones for Social Care and Health. Annual reports for people with disabilities living independently. It does state that you are working to launch prepaid cards for people who receive direct payments as an alternative for the way payments are being made. Now, my question is, having spoken to a few people with disabilities who aren't happy with this, I'm wondering whether we've had any consultations yet, has anything done, or if they haven't, could you give us an indication of what she's doing to do a consultation with people and what the results are, and if there have been some, kind of when we see it.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Thank you, Chris. I think we're going to have to do a lot of work really in seeing what actually suits people, because obviously people with disabilities have such a range. Some consultations have been done, and we've looked at other areas as well that have been using it. But I think, you know, if it's one-to-one consultation with some of ours, but I'll keep you updated with anything that's happening in specifically. Thank you.
Thank you. I said I'm going to have Councillor Elderton, then Councillor Lewis, then Councillor Mitchell, because you were standing. I'll bring you in then.
Yeah, thank you, Madam Mayor. A relatively simple question, I believe, for the Cabinet Member for delivering differently, Councillor Chris Spriggs.
She's not here, Councillor Elderton, so you will get a written response.
I've lodged the question anyway, yeah.
Well, you can lodge the question, yes, for a written response from it.
Can I understand? Can the Cabinet Member eventually tell us when the risk report by PricewaterhouseCoopers costing £79,000 into integration of health and social services will be published?
We're keen to know when that is going to be published.
Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor
Elderton.
Councillor Lewis.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. A question to the Cabinet Member for Housing and Community Safety on page 32 of his report, page 32 of the report, item 2 in regards to ensuring Wirral's neighbourhoods are safe. Councillor Davies reports the welcoming use of antisocial behaviour is down by 11%, is now at the lowest level for 10 years. Councillor Davies will be aware there are several hotspots, and reference has been made to problem with scramble bikes. Last week, Madam Mayor, I met with 20 members of a new group called Wirral Bikers Against Bike Theft, who are concerned about their bikes being stolen. Would he arrange with me for a meeting with them, with the Police and Crime Commissioner, to discuss the police's approach to that problem in the borough, please?
So, the quick answer to that one is absolutely yes.
Thank you. For Councillor Mitchell first. Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Again, it's to the Councillor Whittingham. It's in relation to the last paragraph of his report. What process and what pressure will be putting on United Utilities to maintain the access covers that are part of our major highway? I can point out at least 8 in the ward that I represent on the major road, Gate 41, which are at least 2, if not 3 inches below the level of the highway. Thank you, Madam Mayor. I'm assuming these are calling you bosses. you've not had a, if you've not had a satisfactory response, let me know locations I'll look into for you.
Okay, thank you. Okay, Councillor Rowlands.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. This is to the Cabinet Member for Transport, Councillor Stuart. And this is from your report on page 4.
Hang on. Councillor Rowlands, Councillor Whittingham's now, this has been the sixth question he's been asked. So, and track has been kept of that. The Cabinet Members are only required to answer 5 questions. Okay?
It's only
a technical question. The point is, there are other people.
It doesn't say 5 hostile questions. I'm not going to say that. I'm going to say that. I'm going to say that. I'm going to say that.
Councillor Whittingham, do you want to take the question? One more to Councillor Whittingham.
Councillor Whittingham, can you give me an update on the pothole fund?
You will find it on the website at the end of the financial year that how the possible funds are being spent, and you find it fully spent, will be set out as set out in the grant by the FT.
Thank you. Thank you. Right, Councillor Lewis, I'll take you again, first on your feet. I think we must be getting round to nearly the end of question time now. Somebody watching the clock? Yes? Another 10 minutes? Okay. Councillor Lewis, then Councillor
Clements,
then Councillor
Berry. Okay, thank you. Thank you, Madam Mayor. I'm not keeping counter questions to the Cabinet Member for Children's Services, but my question relates to item 3 of their report. Reference has been made already to universal infant preschool meals. Madam Mayor, I understand early indications are that a further 50,000 children are going to be eligible for free school meals because of the changes in universal credit, not a reduction. But can she confirm whether this council completed and took part in the consultation undertaken by the DfE towards the end of last year on the proposals to change the eligibility for free school meals? And if she is aware of that, can she show us a copy of the council's response? And if she's not aware of it, could she let us know by email a bit later?
Thank you.
You know me, I'm a DfE factor, so I'll check up to make sure that everything that you get, all the information gets correct. So I will do that and write, if you don't mind. I'll check with the officers.
Thank you, Councillor Mooney. Councillor Cllr.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I apologise for earlier, Madam Mayor. Just thought I was parking a question, but there you go. So, Councillor Mooney, could you please tell us if you've met with the people who are opposed to the pop-up Berkeley Centre to allay their concerns and hear their views?
I haven't personally, but the officers met with them today down at the Berkeley Centre, and after sitting down and having a really good constructive conversation and then shown around the centre, everybody went away. The feedback I've had is that people are happy with the centre, they know it's a safe environment, they welcome it, it's a fabulous thing to be happening, giving women more choice. It's a choice you remember to home birth, it's not a choice from hospital birth, it's a completely different thing, two different things. But the people who were there today who were opposed have all left, and we've had no complaints, everybody's left feeling that it's a safe environment and everybody's happy, so I'm really looking forward to it. It's a fabulous thing for women and it's a fabulous thing for Seacombe.
Thank you. Councillor Berry.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. My question is for the leader, Councillor Phill Davies. And the question is, while this is good to hear about the redevelopment that's taking place right across Wirral, as per his report, I'm very concerned to learn that the proposed sale of the Airfield Court site, which has a site valuation of £900,000, is being offered to the developer of the living for the bargain price of £650,000. An excellent deal for Alpha Living, but not so good for the Wirral taxpayer. Can the leader explain how our cash-strapped authority can afford to offer this developer such a bargain basement deal with a £250,000 discount?
Thank you. Councillor Davies.
Yeah, I'll give Councillor Berry a written reply to that question.
Okay. Any further questions?
Councillor Fowles. As we are leaders in areas and Cabinet Members, I just pose this question to the Cabinet Member, Councillor Ben Mooney. If it was such good news on the preschool news, why was the people of Northern Ireland had to be bought off during the debate? I think if it's bad for Northern Ireland, it's probably bad for the North West.
Right,
well,
that's a rhetorical question. You wanted to respond to it. Come on.
It would need a response to be better than an order. I agree with you, Steve.
Thank you. Any further questions? Okay, well, I think we've done really well this evening. We've had a good variety of questions. In this, my last council meeting, we've had a good variety of questions. I think many members have had the opportunity to ask questions, and all the Cabinet members have responded. And for those Cabinet members who aren't here, written responses will be received by members shortly. So I'm moving on now. And we've done that in 35 minutes. So we're 10 minutes to the second. Moving on to agenda item 7. Agenda item 7 is members' general questions, and I understand that Councillor Gilchrist has indicated he may want to ask the question to Councillor Stuart Whittingham. Would you like to put that question, Councillor Gilchrist?
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I'll get the rules. The question is as follows. The new Chester Road between Bolton Road and Stanley Bay Houston has many sets of traffic lights which continue to be plagued by faulty loop wires, timing and capacity problems. When can users of this main road and traffic joining from the housing estates, retail and business parks expect to have a system that actually works for the benefit of all those road users?
Sorry,
Councillor Whittingham, please. Thank you, Madam Mayor, thank you, Councillor Gilchrist, for the advanced notification of the question. As I understand, this has been previously explained. However, I will remember the full response yet again. We are currently using equipment and the communication systems for locations on Newchester Road, Birkenhead and Heswell that can no longer be maintained due to its age. Most of the equipment was originally installed over 20 years ago, where the scales, the coordination and time adjustments that can be provided by the central computer system is lost. When fully operational, central computers can also help to reduce the effects of the individual detector faults. Funding to upgrade communications has recently been approved by the Liverpool City Region Combined Authority. The process to carry out the upgrade will take many months from deciding most appropriate, most cost-effective forms of communication to obtain and installing the necessary equipment. All the forces in the Liverpool City Region are in the same position. Depending on the cause of the individual detector faults and resources available, these are dealt with as soon as possible.
Thank you, Councillor Whittingham.
No.
Yeah. I'm moving on now to agenda item 8, vacancies. Agenda item 8 is vacancy, general vacancies of committee membership, and I've been notified of one change. Councillor Ian Lewis to replace John Hay as a full member of the Business Overview and Scrutiny Committee. Do we have a mover, please?
Move a replacement for Councillor Christina Muskrat as Deputy Member of the Children's Scrutiny Committee, and with your permission, I'll supply a name following this meeting.
Okay,
we
have a second for that? Second, okay. Is that agreed? Councillor agree to that? Yes, thank you. Moving on to agenda item 9, matters requiring consideration. We now turn to item 9 on pages 57 to 144 of the Council agenda, which include various recommendations requiring approval or consideration. We shall first deal with executive considerations, then we'll move on to matters referred from committees. So, first is item 9A on pages 57 to 84 of the agenda. And this is a decision of the Cabinet Member for Housing and Community Safety and Deputy Leader of the Council of the 21st of December 2017 recommending adoption of a revised local development scheme, and that the scheme comes into effect on the day following the council resolution. I now invite Councillor George Davies as the cabinet member to move the recommendation as contained in the agenda, pages 57 to 84 of your papers. Councillor Davies.
So moved.
Thank you. Is there a seconder? Councillor Reilly. Thank you. All those in favour in respect of the recommendation of agenda 9A, please clearly indicate. That's clearly carried, thank you. Okay, I'm now moving on to item 9B on pages 85 to 106 of the agenda. I now invite the Chair and Vice Chair of the Cabinet, Councillors Phil Davies and George Davies, to move and second the recommendation of the Cabinet meeting of the 26th of February 2018 with regard to the calendar of meetings for 2018-19.
So
now, notice has been given of an amendment to this recommendation set out on page 1 of the supplementary papers. So may I ask Councillor Phil Gilchrist and Dave Mitchell to move and second their amendment.
So moved, Madam Mayor. Second it, Madam Mayor.
Okay. Councillor Davies, you now have up to 5 minutes to speak to the recommendation.
Well, I'm simply going to move the calendar as printed, and we will be opposing the Liberal Democrats amendment. We do not believe there are insufficient opportunities to debate policy and hold cabinet members to account. Indeed, we just had a long session of questions, which we didn't actually fill out for the 45 minutes, which says to me that there is ample time for cabinet members to be questioned. We clearly have a whole series of other mechanisms within our constitution, for example, call-ins of cabinet decisions, and we have written members' questions, and there are ample other opportunities that members could always email cabinet members. So I don't believe that there are insufficient opportunities which necessitate bringing everybody in for a separate council meeting. I think the mechanisms are all already there within scrutiny to ensure that all cabinet members are properly held to account. So we will be voting against the Liberal Democrat amendments and voting in favour of the calendar as printed. Thank you, Madam Mayor.
Thank you, Councillor Davies. Councillor Gilchrist, you now have up to 5 minutes to speak to your amendment.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I don't think we embark on this perhaps frivolously, but we don't embark on it lightly. Just because it worked well tonight and we got the expanded time and members felt satisfied they had the answers, I should remind Council that it's only a few weeks since we met many of the subjects that might have raised were rehearsed then. But then I'd ask members to look at the calendar and think about that long gap right across the summer, from July right through to October and November. One of the things that's in my mind, of course, is that questions are confined to the cabinet members' report. But members have endeavoured to find ways around that, and members perhaps need to enjoy that on this occasion. But I'm sure we can bring occasions to mind where question time has not been as polite and constructive as this one, where members are burning issues they wanted to raise. We're also conscious that when extraordinary council meetings have been called, they often occurred at a time that suits members and is at the mayor's discretion. But sometimes there's been a long gap between members who want to get an issue before this council and the extraordinary meeting taking place. And therefore, extraordinary meetings have been tacked on before or after other meetings, leaving members dissatisfied.